You're listening to Themes and Memes, a different kind of movie review. My name's Adam, and here with me I have my co-host Aaron. How are you doing, Aaron?
Very well. Good to be here again, Adam.
It is good to be here. And I think this is possibly the most cursed podcast we've done in a long time.
that takes some doing, too.
It does.
We've had some curses, especially of late.
We have.
It's me toting around that Hope Diamond that I got from the Smithsonian too.
Uh-oh.
Much. Sorry.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. It's so shiny and blue, you just can't... Once you grab it, you don't want to get rid of it. Forget the curse.
Yeah. So we're going to be reviewing the film Now You See Me 2 today. So this is a film that's come out this year, a few months ago, and it is of course, the sequel to the first film, Now You See Me. And we covered that film as one of our very first reviews, I think, all the way back in episode 4, I believe it was.
Yeah, that was right at the beginning when we officially started Themes and Memes, for sure. I think it was 4.
Yeah, pretty sure it was.
In fact, I know it was 4 because it was just after Assault on Wall Street, which I know was 3. So yeah, it's our fourth review as Themes and Memes.
Yeah.
We're back. This is the first film that we've reviewed, the first and the sequel then too, right?
Yeah. It's going to be interesting because, you know, first time doing that, to look at a film that we touched on, or a franchise, or a, you know, a series that we touched on all the way back in episode 4, which is back in, I think, early 2014. Was that about right? I think, was that when we started?
Ooh, now you're going to stump me. Yeah, that sounds about right.
I'm pretty sure. I've been doing all this stuff, putting all this stuff on YouTube recently, so the dates are kind of burned into my head now. So I think I'm pretty sure that's it. It's, yeah. So we're looking at 2 years down the track, thereabouts. Probably more than 2 years down the track. Yeah, reviewing that film again, or that series again. And excuse me. The second film is fairly similar to the first one, I guess. And it's the same kind of premise, isn't it, really?
Very, very similar. Yeah, I mean, it's a sequel, so, you know, it's just a. I mean, what can you say? It's the same movie where they try to come up with something else that happens. So, yeah, it's all the same character. Well, actually, they switched out the actress character.
It's
different,
sure.
In this. Yeah, they swapped her out. Other than that, it's all the same cast, really.
Yeah, that's right. I think the story was that she was actually pregnant and she couldn't do the shoot, so they got a replacement in for this film. However, I have heard that they are actually planning a third film and that she'll be returning for that. So, I mean, as to where they're going to go with the third film, I don't know. But, I mean, I guess we can touch on that towards the, you know, the end of the discussion here. But I guess we'll start off with a synopsis. So I'll, you know, I can go through that, and you can you know, jump in, and we can discuss the, you know, the way that the plot moves, and then after that's done, we can just touch on any kind of observations or side notes.
Yep. So what happens in this crazy film?
Well, so just to recap, the first film, Now You See Me, is essentially about four magicians with varying specialities, and they're being summoned to enter this Order of the Eye. You know, this is a secret society of magicians, very mysterious. You know, we don't really know much about them.
Dates back to Egypt.
Yeah, it takes
the four magicians are referred to as the Four Horsemen.
Yeah.
Symbolic.
Lots of that going on. It's replete with that kind of stuff. So they're summoned to enter this Order of the Eye by an anonymous kind of request, I suppose. And the idea is that they're going to be pulling off these, like, a series of grand spectacles, you know, involving heists, you know, con jobs, and basically, like, psychological operations. So these big, you know, public illusions that are broadcast on television. And the idea is that this is all about bringing about order and justice by exposing corruption. So they are recruited initially by the billionaire Arthur Tressler, and he provides them with the resources to pull off this big televised heist on a bank in France, I believe. And they pull this off, which of course attracts the attention of the FBI and Interpol. We see Interpol agent Alma and FBI agent Dylan Rhodes chasing them, trying to figure out what's going on. But after pulling off this heist, they are then instructed covertly by the Eye to actually turn against Tressler and expose him. So although that he had presumably recruited them to do this bank heist in the first place, they're then told by the Eye that, actually, no, this guy's corrupt. You need to expose him too. And after they do this, it prompts Tressler to recruit former magician turned skeptic Thaddeus Bradley to expose the treachery of the horsemen. So he tries to, you know, get back at them with the help of this kind of debunker skeptic guy, which is the guy played by Morgan Freeman. However, Tressler's efforts are in vain, of course, as both he and Bradley end up being framed and arrested. And this pretty much concludes the end of the first film. So we see, Tressler and Bradley going behind bars, and FBI agent Rhodes actually reveals himself to be the fifth horseman who had been instructing them all along. And they are thus initiated into the eye. So that's just a quick refresher on the first film. But the second film starts out, I think it's like circa 1960s, and we're shown Dylan Rhodes' father, who was a magician named Lionel Shrike. And
yeah, that's right.
You remember that? Yeah. And so he's he's attempting one of these Houdini type escape tricks, you know, where he locks himself inside a safe and the safe is dropped off a crane into a lake and he's got to get out. But of course, it goes terribly wrong. He's killed. So the young Dylan is witnessing this, and he actually believes that this has been done at the behest of Thaddeus Bradley, because Thaddeus Bradley, even at that time, was Lionel Shrike's biggest critic. You know, he was trying to expose him as a fraud.
And that again is Morgan Freeman, the skeptic guy.
Yeah, so, that's right.
Yeah, he's on TV saying he's about to do this. Is it going to work? Yeah.
So this of course inspires Rhodes to try and frame him, to try and get revenge on him, which he manages to pull off in the first film. But we then move back into the present day, and it shows you that the four horsemen are basically living under the radar and trying to evade the FBI following their last grand illusion. So it's about a year on from the last film. And although they were previously initiated into the Eye, they are yet to receive word or instruction from them. You know, so they haven't really heard anything from the Eye. And the character of Atlas, which is played by Jesse Eisenberg, is getting fed up with this, and so he seeks them out to request instruction, saying, look, you know, we've been waiting patiently, what's going on here, can you tell us what we're supposed to be doing? And he is led into a dark underground chamber, and is cryptically told by some kind of a hidden voice that he and the horseman should be patient, that the eye, you know, knows what's best essentially, but that if he is daring enough, his brilliance will surely be rewarded. So he's kind of given a hint that, hey, you know, you should really be waiting, but if you don't wait, you know, good things will come to you. And
and the whole time the Dylan guy, Mark Ruffalo, is kind of like the leader. So, like, he's going to tell him what to do, but he hasn't, and they're getting all frustrated with him,
too. Yeah, that's right. That's a good point. They're fed up with him, too. And this is why the character of Atlas goes and seeks out the eye directly. He kind of goes around Rhodes, essentially, you know, he's breaking the code or what have you. But yeah, he's pretty pissed off with them. But after this, we're shown Rhodes giving the horseman the next assignment. So he does come forth and say, hey, look, this is what we're doing next. And the idea is that they're going to expose a corrupt software entrepreneur called Owen Case. Now, Owen Case has been using his new technology, I think it's like smartphone or social media stuff, to secretly mine the user's personal data. But reference to Mark Zuckerberg there, I think, pretty obviously, or people like him. And as you mentioned before, Aaron, we also see that the character of Henley from the first film has left the horseman, and she's been replaced by the amateur but talented magician Lula. So they successfully hijacked this launch party for the software, and, you know, this is all to the applause of the crowd. The crowd hasn't seen the horseman in a year, so they're all cheering and waiting to see what's going to happen. But the act is actually interrupted, and the secrets are all exposed by some kind of mysterious hacker who takes control of the show. And so Rhodes is, throughout this, revealed to be the horseman's mole in the FBI. So his cover is blown. He has to escape the FBI. And it's also revealed that the character of Wilder, who's one of the four horsemen, is actually still alive, because in the previous film we had seen him die, supposedly. But we're basically, it's revealed that this was a philosophical death. And that gets back to some of the kind of symbolism with the tarot cards that they bring up in both films. But when the horsemen try to escape this, sort of launch party, it's revealed... Well, it's not revealed. What happens is that, they try to escape, and they are drugged and captured and taken to Macau, China, without realizing it. And they're then introduced to the character of Walter Mabry, and he's played by Daniel Radcliffe. And he is the former business partner of Owen Chase, so the guy, you know, who came up with this software idea. And they basically, he threatens them. He threatens the horsemen with exposure unless they go and steal a particular type of computer chip for him. And the idea that this computer chip is a data mining device. You know, it can hack any device on the world and just, you know, copy all of its information. So they're at first reluctant. You know, they're not too happy about the idea of doing this. But Atlas vouches for them. He says, no, we can do this. And he's obviously thinking back to his dialogue with the Eye, where the Eye said, you know, you need to be brave and dauntless, and your brilliance will be rewarded, of course. And so that they agree to do this. But then Atlas goes and contacts the Eye, and, you know, covertly, of course, and says, well, hey, look, we've been asked to do this. And what will happen is that when I've actually stolen this chip, we'll hand it over to you, the Eye, instead of this guy Mabry, so that it doesn't fall into the wrong hands. And yeah, so that they start preparing for their mission or their heist or what have you. And they visit this magic shop in China, and they're given assistance by this, it looks to be some kind of like an underground fraternity of amateur magicians who are kind of mysterious. Mm-hmm. It's not a lot of focus is paid to them. But
it looked like a family, like a grandma and a grandson or something that happened to work in the magic shop.
Yeah.
Was that it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It was a grandmother and a grandson working in the magic shop, and they're kind of humble and goofy and unassuming. But they seem to be
the young guy is like doing these dumb tricks, like, ooh, hey, oh, you want to buy something, and he's like doing these lame magic tricks, and they're like, yeah, okay, whatever,
yeah,
just let us do our thing.
yeah, that's right. And so they're preparing for the heist, and meanwhile, as this is happening, Rhodes, of course, this is back in America, Rhodes has been branded a fugitive, you know, through his exposure, and of course, he can't return to the FBI because of this, they're looking for him. So he forges his credentials and visits prison, and he releases Thaddeus Bradley. And the idea is that, Thaddeus can help him uncover the whereabouts of the horseman. And Bradley informs him that there's a bigger game being played than Rhodes understands, and that he will have his revenge on Rhodes in good time. He's basically saying, look, there's more going on here than you understand, and I will also have my revenge on you. However, if you choose to save your friends rather than save yourself, then I can help you. You know, so it's up to you. Are you going to save yourself and run, or will you stay with me and save your friends at, you know, at your own expense? And of course, Rhodes, chooses to do the right thing and consult Bradley. So back in China, the horsemen managed to infiltrate this computer facility and steal the chip using a complex series of distractions and sleight of hand techniques. I think it's like they're basically using the card trick techniques to get this chip out of there.
Yeah, they grab it, and then they're always throwing it back and forth. And that scene seems like it went on for like a half an hour. They're like throwing the card back, and it's like, just get that thing out of there already. I'm going to see this.
Yeah, that was gratuitous.
Was it just me, or was that?
yeah, it was gratuitous.
Like,
it
went on. I know you're going to get it. Just end the scene already and get out of that room. They find that they're good magicians.
Yeah,
they made it out. Not without a lot of difficulty.
That was the that was supposed to be the one of the big, you know, acts within the film, was this whole card trick type uh-huh. sequence there, where there's four mm-hmm. of them trying to get this computer chip out of a high tech security place, and they're all slipping it down sleeves and throwing it and holding it behind their hands.
And Woody Harrelson is the mentalist stage hypnotist, so this isn't his specialty. So he's been trying to learn from the other guy on these techniques leading up to this. And so, you know, this is the big test, and he almost drops it once, but somebody reaches out to grab it, and they almost got caught because of it, but they made it out.
Yeah, they made it out.
I don't know why I had to say that, but again, this is so annoying to me, this part. I just wanted it to be over.
Yeah, I remember watching that thinking, okay, so they're about to get out. No, okay. It just goes on and on.
It just goes on. It keeps going. It's like, geez.
It's just one of those, hey, look at us, aren't we clever moments, really, you know, so.
Yeah, and it's sort of like, again, an action sequence, or, you know, something exciting has happened on the edge of your seat, you know, it's...
I think that's one of the ideas
involved, you know, so it's not just a bunch of boring talking going on, we get something exciting happening.
Well, this is the...
To me, the action sequences and the things that are supposed to be exciting bore me, whereas the talking and the all that stuff is what what interests me personally these days.
Absolutely. I totally agree. It's funny because when I was reading reviews of the film, most critics were saying, oh, the action sequences are really boring. It promises to amaze you with all of this sleight of hand stuff, and it just doesn't deliver. And I'm thinking, well, is that really why you're watching this film? I mean, that's not why I'm watching this film. But I suppose that's a mainstream audience for you.
Yeah. That's what people go for, because they basically are watching it for the same reasons that they would watch a real magic act.
Yeah.
They want to be dazzled. They want to see some spectacle, something exciting.
Yeah, that's it.
Definitely.
Of course, you know, and the I guess the esoteric story is going to be lost on, you know, the average critic. So what do you expect?
Yeah. But, yeah, that's the way it goes.
So back to the synopsis, So the horsemen have managed to get this chip out of this facility, and of course Atlas gets it and thinks, well, right, I've got to go and hand it over to the Eye now because I promised it to them. And so he organizes a meet in some kind of a marketplace, and he arrives there and he's actually confronted by Mabry, the guy who, you know, asked him to go and steal it. And of course Mabry's laughing and saying, well, haha, I'm actually the mysterious voice of the Eye. That was me. I hacked into this thing. I led you there. And what I've done is baited you into this whole scenario by appealing to your ego and your desire for fame. So I thought that was quite an interesting scene there, because they explain a bit of psychology and suggestion in terms of how this this magician who's supposed to be, I guess the idea is that they're kind of immune to things like suggestion or NLP themselves or psychological persuasion, mm-hmm. but it shows that through ego, you know, that's the only button you need to push with him. And they got him to do, Mabry got him to do what he wanted simply by placating him and appealing to his ego, you know?
That was the big theme in the first film too, is like, don't let your ego get the best of you. I'd say that was like the major thing in the film, actually.
Absolutely.
They bring it back up here.
And of course we see the full of the tarot deck coming up over and over mm-hmm. again throughout this film and the first film. But at this point, Rhodes appears in China. So he's obviously tracked it down, and he intervenes, and he pretends to steal the device from Atlas and allows Atlas to escape. But at that point, Rhodes is abducted by Mabry, and says, you know, because he wants to get the chip off him, and he's taken to see Mabry's father, who turns out to be the billionaire Arthur Tressler, who had apparently recruited the horseman in the first film, then had them turn against him, then apparently was locked up, and now it turns out he's behind the whole thing. So, you know, big reveal. Yeah. And
Of course, you got the British, the English villains here is father and son, right? So that's a fun movie trope that we love here in America, is that big evil English villain. Can't get enough of that.
You got Michael Caine as the father and Daniel Radcliffe as the son.
It's very silly.
And it's a kind of like a UK versus America type theme as well, if you look at it that way. Because there's a lot of that kind of one-upmanship going on in this film. It's all about getting one over on the other guy and getting revenge on the mm-hmm. competition and making somebody else look like a fool. And so, I think that's brought up the characters there. But Tressler tries to kill Rhodes. And what he does is try to re-escape the very escape act that killed his father in the first place. So, you know, he forces Rhodes into the safe and drops the safe into a river. But Rhodes, of course, manages to escape. And the horsemen find him, but soon after they realize that the chip they've stolen is fake, and this of course leaves the question of who has the real chip. Now what they decide to do is Rhodes is working with the horsemen again, you know, they've resolved their differences apparently, and they start organizing a massive series of illusions to be performed on River Thames in London on New Year's Eve. And so, you know, they're broadcasting all of this publicity, promotional stuff all over the world and saying...
They're back in the public eye again doing their magic show.
Yeah, back in the public eye in a very, very big way. You know, all of a sudden, you know, after being in hiding and under the radar for a year, they're sort of like, you know, they're on every channel, it seems. And... this, of course, prompts Mabry and Tressler to realize that, oh, right, Rhodes is still alive, and these guys are still on the loose, and they must have the chip. You know, I think this is going to be their big reveal, is they're going to come out, you know, on New Year's Eve in London and expose this chip to the world. And so this prompts them to intervene and try and, they capture both the horsemen and Rhodes. And so they put them on a plane.
Take the plane.
Yep. Yeah. Excuse me. And so flying on this plane, and they're all sitting there, and Mabry and Tressler are basically revealing the whole thing to the horsemen and saying, oh, you know, we're going to get you. And they're kind of confessing to how they've pulled off this whole thing. And they're holding up the chip and all this type of stuff. And they then say, right, well, we've got to get rid of you guys. And so they start literally throwing them out of the plane in mid-flight one by one, just, you know, killing them. Mm-hmm. But no sooner has the last horseman been pitched out of the plane than it's revealed that the plane never actually took off in the first place. And that it is actually sitting on a barge in the River Thames with the engines on and with rain and all the rest of it to make it look like it's flying. And of course, the horsemen have placed cameras throughout this plane, and they've captured the entire sequence of events and the confessions from both characters. And, you know, that the entire complex deception is revealed to the world. You know, the horsemen tell everybody how they did this and how they fooled them into getting into a plane that, you know, wasn't actually a plane, and all this type of stuff. And, the FBI intervene, of course. They're on the case, and they get Mabry and Tressler, but they do give former agent Rhodes an opportunity to escape. So Rhodes' boss kind of feels sorry for him and says, well, look, I can see you're one of the horsemen, but you're not against us, you're kind of on our side, so I'm going to look the other way while you escape. And the film ends with Rhodes and the horsemen then being taken to a secret underground library at the Greenwich Observatory. And this is, in London. And they're led there by Lee, who I think was the grandmother in the Chinese magic shop, if I'm correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so they go into this underground library, and they meet Thaddeus Bradley. So Thaddeus is down there. And he actually informs them that he is actually a senior member of the Eye. And he goes on to explain to them that he was, in fact, Lionel Shrike's partner. So Rhodes' father, Thaddeus Bradley, Thaddeus being Rhodes' biggest enemy or nemesis, was actually his father's partner. And that his role of critic and skeptic, his role as a big public debunker was all part of cementing the illusion. You know, he was just playing his role out. And, he reveals that the entire sequence of deceptions and revelations was orchestrated by the Eye as a greater initiation ritual for both Rhodes and Horsemen. And that that Mabry and Tressler were lured in as useful idiots to play an important role in the game. And that's pretty much where it ends. It's revealed that the grandmother and the grandson that we mentioned before from the Chinese magic shop, they are, of course, members of the Eye. We see them in there. And the film ends with Rhodes being asked by Bradley to succeed him in his role in the Eye. So, Thaddeus Bradley says to Rhodes, look, I want you to succeed me and take over my position or what have you at some point in the future. So, big revelation at the end.
Yeah, it still leaves it open as to whatever his position is and what's going on. And I guess presumably the third film would get into what the Eye actually does and stuff like that, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, who knows? We'll see. But there's a lot.
I'm surprised they made a second one, to be quite honest. I didn't know how well the first one actually did.
Yeah, I think the consensus is that the first one was better thus far anyway. I've seen a lot of reviews, and of course in conspiracy media everybody's pulling apart the symbolism, as you would expect. Of which the film is replete, of course. Not so much the second one. But I would almost say, and you can feel free to disagree with me on this, but I would almost say that there is possibly more the story I believe in the second one is more esoteric, and there's more of an occult significance to it, if you will. I think.
Overall, I got the feeling that the movie again wasn't a very good movie. The first one wasn't very good either. It just was basically a bad movie with a whole bunch of really profound ideas thrown on top of it. And in so doing, it becomes like a decent movie just because the ideas are so profound. I mean, they're really big, important ideas.
That's what I'm getting at, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, the first one was really good. This one, I gotta admit, I was a little tired when I watched it. So I was like, oh gosh. And they're constantly like doing these like weird scenes that go on, and they're telling the dumb jokes every 5 seconds. It's like, oh man, it was draining me. But you know, I mean, I was like, by the end, I was like, oof, okay. But I get what you're saying with the, you know, Morgan Freeman revealing that, you know, he was just playing a role the whole time. And this spans two films. And he was like, you know, this big bad guy debunker who was against the magicians. Well, no. They're just working together. And that's pretty worthy of thinking about how, you know, you get these characters in the public discourse or public narrative of some kind who appear to be enemies who are nothing but they're actually buddies in the secret society. They're working on the same goal, and you would never think that on the exoteric level, but if you sit down and you think about it, when you have some information to understand what's actually going on, it makes perfect sense. It's like, oh yeah, okay, I see how that works. And that's kind of how magic works too, because you get you've got these like covert assistants in the audience, or you know, the assistant is helping you do sleight of hand. It's always like not just the magician, he's working with other people to help the you know, direct the attention of the audience away from what's actually happening.
Yes.
It's all about where the attention of the audience is going.
I think this is it. And I agree that I think this is probably the most profound part of the film, because what it's about is about both sides being part of the same act. You know, it's about it's about the idea of something that is grand, something that is sensational, something which is full of emotion and is full of conflict. And, you know, you've got on one side somebody saying one thing, on the other side somebody, you know, really, really trying to argue the opposite. And finding out that, you know, both sides are working for the same, well, that both sides are one and the same. I think that's a really interesting concept. And, I guess it's concepts like that within this film, which I'm getting at when I say that it was good to watch. And I agree, it's not a good film by any normal measure, because it has so much of this type of stuff in it. It keeps my attention, you know. And I do, of course,
get it does
bored to tears by all this card trick stuff, you know. But you know, but these concepts to do with deception, to do with the idea of secret societies, to do with the idea of initiation. And illusion, and everything being a test, and both sides, you know, the illusion of separateness being, you know, being revealed as the same thing. And I think those are really interesting threads. So.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I guess the father, the Shrike character, who dies in the beginning, back in the flashback, the past. He's much like Houdini. Again, he's in a Houdini-style trick. And if you're tying into the real world, Houdini was had intelligence connections. I mean, he was basically an intelligence agent that was working under the cover of, you know, his act, his magic act, his escape artist act. So, you know, they're pointing out very real-world things here. This, and Houdini's not the only magician, escape artist, whatever, to be like this. You've got... Was it Yuri Geller, right? Isn't he the other guy?
He was the
big intelligence connections, you know.
He
him?
Was the he was the involved in all of that I guess what do you call it, like the MK Ultra paranormal type stuff from the Cold War, you know, to do with spoon bending and remote viewing.
Yes,
and
that's right.
All that stuff we touched on in Stranger Things, yeah.
Mm-hmm. He freely admitted, like, oh yeah, yeah, I work for, what was it, MI5, isn't that what he said, MI5 agent or something?
MI6 maybe, something like that, yeah, one of those.
Yeah, he just came out and said, oh yeah, I'm intelligence agent, and he just freely says that. So then, when you think of that, anybody who is actually thinking, you go, okay, so was this whole spoon bending bit and everything that he was famous for, was that some sort of ploy to get us looking in a wrong direction? And was he doing that? And was that his job? And, you know, what's the real story here? It gets you wondering what the real story is. And you don't really know, because you're not on the inside. But he's telling the intelligence agent. But then the trick is deciphering what the importance of that actually is.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think... that if you were to just go with the simplest explanation on that, something like that, it would be that the idea with him was that he was to go out there and create this kind of a mystery and create this kind of sensationalism and put out these amazing stories about paranormal abilities and you know, telekinesis and remote viewing or whatever the hell it was, you know, to capture the public's imagination, to capture their attention, to create controversy, to create mystery, and just to get everybody looking in a certain direction or focusing all of their energy on something which was completely vacuous and of no real consequence, something that essentially just been fabricated for the purposes of perhaps distracting people's attention from something else. This could be counterintelligence to try and subvert, Russian intelligence. What are they called again? KGB.
KGB. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Something like that. Because this was done in the Cold War plenty of times. You know, not just in the Cold War, but we've seen it throughout the 20th century. Intelligence agents putting out ridiculous nonsense and creating mystery and distractions and sensationalism as a way of getting the enemy's intelligence services to focus in on that, to try and think about it, to try and figure it out, you know, and of course distract them.
Magic is such stage magic in particular, definitely magic overall, but stage magic is such a good way to portray this because it's all about directing attention. It's all about where's the audience attention at, and that point is so deep and so important, and so much about what actual intelligence work is. It's about, okay, all these so-called secrets that our government and our rival government are actually freely available. Anybody can dig them up. Anybody can find this stuff out, really. It doesn't take that much work to do it. The trick is confusing everybody, the intelligence agencies of the rival governments, and more importantly, the public at large, as to what in the world is actually going on. You're putting out these stories to confuse everybody. And again, it's all it takes is just like, hey, look over there. See that?
Yeah.
There's a thing happening over there, and there could be nothing happening, but you get the attention of the entire world looking over there. Meanwhile, you're doing the real business actually right up on stage, and nobody even sees it. And they would if they sat there looking at it, but you just point at something and you make it spectacular. And that's all it takes.
Yeah, that's all it takes. It's all about the idea of the sleight of hand, you know. And there's actually a quote that they use in the first film, and I think they might have been brought out again in the second film, but I definitely remember it in the first one. What do they say? I'm springing it up here. No, I had it here. No, I'll have to find it. It's basically like something like the closer you look, the less you'll see. And it's a bit more extended than that. Try and figure it out. Look closer.
Yeah, that's right. They say the more you think you have it, the more you investigate and think you know what's going on, the less you know.
you're just
fooling yourself into thinking, because you're following the line that's been placed before you. You've been following the bread trail.
Yeah.
The trail breadcrumbs. You're like, oh, yeah, this is the way I solve it. It's like the way a mystery writer writes a mystery. They write in such a way that you're following these certain clues to get you to come to the wrong conclusion. You have to be able to like pick out some little detail that's supposed to be like cryptically hidden in there that gives you the whatever the twist is going to end up being. And it ties into the creation of fiction. It also ties into again intelligence and the way the world stage and all this. So it's very relevant in terms of Hollywood film because these techniques are used to make a film. But then if you're putting ideas that are very real and very powerful in this film, I guess the idea is who's going to pick up on those, even if they're kind of overtly put in there.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, it's interesting the way all that works, and you're right in saying that this is the way that that stagecraft works in general with Hollywood and with the entertainment industry as a whole. It's about understanding how a given pattern of logic will work. About understanding how, if we present facts A, B, and C, then we know for sure that if people follow this particularly linear form of logic, then it will undoubtedly lead them towards conclusion X, Y, and Z. you know. And so this is this is one of the most interesting things about both films, the way that they kind of expose this in a way. And you know, it's not revealed entirely. There's still a lot of sleight of hand and you know, all that kind of stuff. But I think that's really interesting that the way they kind of expose
it deconstructs the process of movie making and storytelling itself, which is odd.
Yeah, it does.
You don't get that a lot in film.
But I mean, it's also somewhat of a ritual process too, of initiation. And we discussed this in the first one, I remember. And that what we see is the horsemen being initiated through a process to get into the secret society, the Eye, and so they are, you know, told to go and do something. They do that. Then more is revealed to them. They go and do the next thing. Then more is revealed to them, and it just keeps going. And so this kind of follows through in the second film as well, where you know they. You know, they think that they understand things. They think they understand the purpose of what they're doing, and of course, then it's revealed that they really don't. And that, you know, things are not as they seem. And then so that they move on to do the next thing. Of course, then that's more is revealed in relation to that. Of course, and
So there's a lot to say here in terms of secret societies and what it is that they do. Definitely, they're at work in the world, and this film is pointing that out. But how is it and what is it that they actually do? This is the big question when it comes to secret societies, and the thing that most people can never pin down and never quite understand. It's always just, what is a secret society and who are they and this, that, and the other. But it's definitely true that they work at a very public level and at a large scale. And even they use large sensational events to conduct their work. Now, they themselves, the members, will never be part of these events, but it's given to understand that they're behind the scenes using their wit and guile to guide forward, right? So as a secret society, the trick is, how do you get attention to your cause? Well, what is the cause is a big question. We can't really get into that with secret societies now, but they have special causes and special goals in mind, and they go about the big way that they move forward with those is informing the public of these ideas and goals, and in a way, really getting the public to do the work for them. And how do you do that? You have to just inform them on the cause and how just and worthy a cause it is. It's like, hey, look, there's a problem here in our society. What are we all going to do about it? And, you know, in this movie, you get the big, you know, the evil guys in power who are corrupt, and we got to depose them, and we got to stand up for ourselves and all this. And, you know, who's doing this? It's the secret society, the Eye. But they're doing it through their lower-level initiates, who are actually some of the most famous people in the world on the world stage, and they're doing these things to convince the public. I hope I'm explaining this.
Yeah, no, I know exactly what you're saying, because you know what they're doing there is essentially it's like the kind of using these famous. Celebrities, essentially, you know, these celebrity magicians to promote the idea that secret societies are essentially forces of like enlightenment and virtue, you know, of balance, of justice, of order, of these types of things. You know, that they are, yes, they are mysterious and they are apparently quite powerful, but ultimately benevolent, and that they are they're acts of deception and illusion. You know, that these mass acts of enormous deception are actually simply a counter. They're a counter move to greed and corruption. So the ends are justified by the means. You know, they're ultimately serving the greater good. So that's the idea that, well, you know, we will use tricks of stagecraft, of sleight of hand. We will deceive you. We will mislead you. We will confuse you. But we're doing so for a higher purpose. You know, we're doing this to bring about some kind of a greater cause or purpose, if you will. So that idea is, I think, quite obviously being, you know, being put across in the film. And I guess it begs the question as to what messages, or you know, what broader messages are being put across in relation to the real world role of secret societies. You know, I mean, is this an attempt to I guess, you know, give the idea of secret societies a facelift? You know, a new public yeah. image? Is that what this is about? Because it kind of seems like that in a lot of ways, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think it's saying in a multi-tiered sense here, it's doing a lot of different things at once. I mean, there's so many different movies like this being made now, and not just movies, but media of all sorts, print media. You get all these things talking about secret societies everywhere. It's a big trend right now. People want to know about it. So, you know, you give, in one sense, you give the people what they want, but in the other sense, you know, you're informing the people. It's like, yeah, these secret societies are real, and yes, they're doing good things. And it's crazy because at the same time, it's just fictionalizing the whole thing too. So the whole you remain veiled beyond real public perception in remaining in that you know, that gray space where, you know, you don't have any proof of anything. You just get a lot of stories about stuff. You know, it's just a bunch of stories. Like a Hollywood movie is a story. You don't believe it. It's just something somebody says.
Yeah.
So it's you know, things that people say, things that people think. It has no bearing on the actual world. But if once you start decoding secret societies and their methods, it has everything to do with everything. It's what people think determines what they do.
Yeah,
and there you have it. And they are telling you this throughout movies like this and everything else here about secret societies. They're all just screaming this at you. And I also think that I think it's a call to recruit people too. I think that's what a lot of this media has to do with, like trying to recruit people. This is a big important time. And if you read the more overt media pieces that secret societies put out, they'll say that just outright, like, oh yeah, this is a very important time, we need to get more people involved in this. You know, in years past, we weren't even able to share these things that we're now lecturing to you about. We're giving lectures and there are not that many people listening, but you know, we're doing them, and some people are showing up. But that, go back 100 years, this was a big no-no, but now we're doing it.
Yeah.
So these are things to think about.
Yeah, they. It's funny though, because in doing this and promoting themselves and promoting the cause and trying to recruit initiates, they reveal only what they want you to see, you know. And so the idea is that we're going to tell you what we're all about, and we're going to educate you and inform you so that you can make the choice as to whether you want to be a part of this. And, you know, we're of course going to tell you that this is all for the greater good, that, you know, we need you to bring about some higher cause. But of course, the true nature of who they are and in this film, who they really answer to is always kept a secret. So, you know, this kind of gets back into the idea of this, these initiation rites. And we've talked about this in many other films where the neophyte, the initiate, the recruit, whoever, you know, be it the audience or be it the person in the film or both, is supposedly given an understanding as to what's going on. And with that understanding, they proceed forward in deconstructing what's happening, you know, in the film or in the environment of the film. But of course, as I said before, there's always a moment of revelation where, you know, they're basically told that what they thought to be the truth was not actually the truth, and that things are not as they seem, and that there's actually a much deeper picture going on with all of this. And so this just seems to, you know, this starts in the first film, it continues on to the second film, and I'd imagine you'd probably see more of it in the third film, where, you know, at each stage of the process, both the audience and the horsemen are initiated into, I guess, higher and higher levels of understanding as to the many layers of deception and illusion that are going on in this environment. So, you know, we're told that we understand things. We're told that, oh, okay, now we really know. And then a few minutes later, it's, oh, actually, no, we didn't know then, but now we really do know, you know, and it just keeps on going.
And, of course, they overtly tell you that, like, the more you think, the less you know. And I like how they use the horseman as a device to show this, too, because
the apocalypse,
in the eyes... Yeah, in the eyes of the audience, both the fictional audience and the real audience watching this movie, they're the ones who know everything, and they're controlling the illusion, and they're the ones, you know, guiding things on this huge world scale. They're the ones in control, right? But when it comes down to it, they don't even know what's going on. They're just being led forward by the eye, And the eye is using them as these big public personas, these big public people to push their agenda. And meanwhile, yes, they're initiating them, but the initiates themselves know nothing. So I think that's a pretty profound statement that's being made about secret societies there. Is anything that, yes, they initiate these big famous people that we're all aware of, and they use them to do their work, but they're basically dupes. The more famous a person is, like, more duped they are. And so, yeah, they're a secret society member, but they're essentially a useful idiot.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this is how it works. I mean, as in a secret society, the information is highly compartmentalized. So everybody is acting according to the information that they have. They're all playing their roles according to what they've been told to do. But none of them have the full story, and they're all beholden to this occult force. You know, this is this thing that sees all but is seen by no one else. You know, so I think that was a pretty accurate kind of, I guess, portrayal of how the secret society structure would work.
The eye sees, right?
The eye sees.
They use the symbol of the London Eye, of course, is right there with the big where the big trick takes place. So it's watching. The eye is watching, I guess you could say. There's that sort of symbolic thing going on.
Yeah. There's a lot of that going on. Of course, this will probably be obvious to most people that in our audience who have watched this film, but there's just replete with this kind of symbolism. So we see the references to the Aeon of Horus, of course, that famous Egyptian Eye of Horus graphic thing, that symbol, you know. We see the tarot come up quite a bit. The Fool, the card of the Fool is used over and over again. So our attention is drawn to the notion of the Fool or that archetype. And
I think the old woman actually explicitly talks about the Fool, like, the Fool is important because of this and that, and I forget, because I forget exactly what she says, but she just sits there, like, again, and it's like a little bit from an occult lecture or something. Like, oh, thank you, that's good to know that.
I think I remember that, but I think they did a fairly good job in kind of looking at, I guess, the multiple levels of interpretation that you get with the Fool, because I think we've discussed this in previous discussions here, where the Fool is not necessarily just one thing. You know, the Fool can be a whole bunch of things, there are both virtues and vices within that archetype. You know, depending on depending on who it is and what the context is.
That's the way everything works in the occult mysteries. Is that it's not just single-tiered, but it's many different layers to reality, and you get one layer, then you go deeper, and you get to the next layer, and they both connect to each other, and they can be seemingly contradictory if you just take them apart and not as part of a bigger whole, but when you realize they are part of a bigger whole, you start to see things.
Yeah.
So this movie points that out, too. It's like, you know, if you're just getting little bits and pieces of information, how are you supposed to know anything, too? You gotta go deeper, and you know, the initiates into the eye here, going deeper and deeper. Again, up to this point, they still don't, the movie ends, and they still don't really know anything. So the journey continues as an initiate, apparently, going.
And I think, if we look at characters like Atlas, for example, the Jesse Eisenberg character, it's an interesting name, actually, Atlas. I found that interesting.
Oh, yeah, oh, goodness. Oh, yeah.
But maybe we can get to that. But he, he's, of course, lured into becoming the Fool himself. So he starts out at the beginning of the film being the one who is, he's decisive, he's taking matters into his own hands, he is going around roads and going straight to the eye and trying to get things happening. But of course he's lured into becoming the Fool on account of his unchecked ego and his ambition, you know? And this kind of ties into the the Fool archetype throughout the rest of the story, where the entire premise of magic and alchemy is really all about ego. You know, it's all about each of the characters, like, getting one over on their enemies, getting one over on the public, deceiving people, manipulating people, raising themselves up above people. There's a big focus on personal vendettas, which are, of course, unvirtuous. And so this is interesting.
Yeah, well, they're big traps, too, and they're seen as such in secret societies. It's like, if you want to play that public game where you're big shot Mr. Know-It-All,
yeah,
prepare to get burned and fall into the trap of your own making, because that's what's going to happen. Yeah. And they very much believe that secret societies. I think it's true, because you go out there as this big blowhard Know-It-All, you're going to get cut down, because anybody can get cut down at any time. You just throw this one little thing at them, and then they go, oh, I don't know what to do about that. Yeah. And then court of public opinion, you're lynched. And the secret society knows this. That's why anybody of any real power remains in the shadows. It's like, I'm not going out there. You think I'm stupid?
Yeah.
I don't need the limelight. Yeah. There's no power in it anyway. It's Fool's Mountain, as they call it.
Fool's Mountain.
True.
Yeah, absolutely.
Big egomaniac wants to climb up there like, look, I'm in control. I know everything. It's like, yeah, right. You shoot a little rubber band gun at him, he falls off.
Yeah. Absolutely. This is absolutely true. And we see, of course, in the film that the Eye, of course, has orchestrated this entire sequence where Atlas gets, the beginning of the film, where Atlas goes to try and seek out the Eye, and goes into this underground chamber, and he's of course duped by the Walter Mabry, who's speaking through speakers in the ceiling or whatever, and placating his ego and all the rest of it. I mean, of course, when it's revealed at the end of the film that the Eye was in control of the whole thing, well, it's actually revealed that the Eye organized that as well. So the Eye essentially baited Mabry into baiting Atlas. So this was a test. This wasn't just something that Walter Mabry decided to do for himself. This is something that the Eye prompted him to do. So again, multiple levels of deception going on there. And this was some kind of a test by the Eye to initiate him into higher understanding, to teach him a lesson, to get his ego in check.
I always like to reiterate this point too, is that, what is a god? It's this unseen creative power. You never see it, but those who have faith know what it does, right?
Yeah.
So it's not about seeing it. And God actually derives a lot of its power in being unseen. And secret societies emulate that thing. They're like, oh, yeah, we're like God because we have all this power and it's mysterious. Nobody knows how it works. We're there, but you don't see us, right? And we'd like to keep it that way. Thank you very much. It's like God keeps it that way, so we will too. We'll just model our method on the divine method.
Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That's how they operate, and that's how they operate in this film, because the lesson that they're trying to teach Atlas there is that he should really be having faith, and that he should see the Eye more as something that is, I suppose, almost metaphysical in a way, and accept that they're headed, rather than trying to drag them out into the light with his ego and saying, show yourselves, show me who you are, tell me what to do. I want something tangible I can feel, see, touch, hear before I'm going to go any further here.
Atlas's big trouble was holding the weight of the world up on his back, right?
Yeah.
That's what he's doing there. He's like trying to – the exoteric world he's trying to hold up as he thinks it exists. It's like, hey, this – let go.
Yeah.
It's the message. Don't hang on. Don't hang on so tightly. Like, all you got to do is let go, and that's where the truth is.
Yeah, there's a lot – A lot going on with this, because again, we are seeing revelation of truth, and we're seeing the truth being veiled in a lot of ways. So all at the same time, we're seeing characters who are beholden to their ego, but who are also virtuous in other ways too. And we, the audience, of course, are in much the same boat, where we are shown certain truths. We these things are revealed to us and exposed, etc. But at the same time, we there's a lot we don't understand because it's being deliberately hidden from us. So, we could probably go on about that forever, really, the multiple layers.
I guess the role of the masses, as it were, the public at large in this whole esoteric project is kind of elucidated here. It's like, they play their role and they do their part, and we use them to fulfill our goals. And the big way we do that, again, is by informing them and putting on a show, something that they can look at and to think about. Because to their mind, thinking and little stories and ideas, they're just
that's just kids stuff. You put it in a little kid's book. Look, think about this, Johnny. It's good for your childhood development, but at an adult level, that thinking doesn't mean anything. Thinking doesn't do anything. But of course, the opposite is very much true. If you can get the masses, the public, to think in a way that is conducive to what you are doing, well, congratulations, you're moving a lot of weight, literally, throughout society. If you can warm people up to these ideas that they weren't warmed to before, you can really get the ball rolling, as it were, right? So yeah. This is how the movers and shakers operate. They operate in the realm of the mind, the realm that most people don't want to deal with, and like, hey, I'm too tired for that business. I want to sit here and watch a magic show on TV. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Little they know subconsciously, the show is telling them all sorts of ideas. It's going to stick in their minds and make them think and see the world in a new way. And they're not even conscious of it.
Well, I think that's probably what this film was about, really. Because as we talked about before, excuse me, most of the reviews are about people's disappointment over the magic acts. You know, the action sequence essentially in the film. They're saying, well, these aren't that impressive. We saw them all in the first film. So what is the film really offering? But, you know, what you're saying is, and I agree with this, is that the more subtextual messages, the kind of persuasions that are being put across in regard to what a secret society is, what kind of role they serve, what kind of people are involved, and what they're all about is in there. It's being suggested to you, pretty strongly. And I think the most interesting kind of aspect of that is when we look at the idea of the eye and the horseman working to expose surveillance. So there's a pretty heavy focus on surveillance here. You know, we've got this computer chip that can hack into anything. We've got a software designer, yes, who's taking people's data. So these are all real world references. And the idea is that the eye, the secret society, this powerful arcane order, is all about exposing that. You know, they see this as a problem. They see this as unjust. And they're going to use their secret society methods and their tricks of deception and illusion to expose this and to bring about order and justice so that the public are not duped. And I think that's interesting because most people in alternative conspiracy media would be familiar with the notion that if they're if we're talking secret societies on a high level, I mean, these are essentially the people who were doing the spying in the first place. I mean, if we look at organizations like the NSA, I mean, the symbolism that they're using in some of their logos and some of the documents they've put out is pretty blatant. Look at like the Total Information Awareness Project by DARPA. I mean, that was literally a pyramid with an eye looking over the world. You know, all of these government seals and logos and all the project names. I mean, these big surveillance programs are being essentially run by the same people as would be in high-level secret societies. You know, the symbolism is all there. Yet in this film, the idea is that, oh, no, these surveillance programs are just the runaway rogue initiatives of some corrupt businessman, and we, the secret societies, are here to stop that. So I think, would you agree in saying that this is kind of the publicity kind of angle that they're going for here in this film, with trying to present themselves as being an opponent of all of this?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought this up, because they frame it in a movie as this science versus magic duel. And Daniel Radcliffe has science on his side, and he gloats about, like, yes, we use science and you use magic. And of course, magic gets beat by science once again. So you set up this dialectic, of course, and like, it's magic and it's science. And, the audience is probably prone to think, oh, yeah, science is going to beat all the superstitious nonsense. But then you come to learn, like, oh, wait, no, magic actually is real, okay. And you get the whole secret society message of, like, yeah, you know, there's a lot more going on than just with the material, this materialistic view of things. And that's true. But again, is that a false dialectic where it's like, yes, science versus magic, or is it it's the real truth?
Well, same thing,
two just go together. And again, this movie kind of points that out, because at the large scale, they just kind of exploit both things to get drive the whole story, the public narrative, forward, right?
Yeah. Right. So just had a few technical problems there. It's been an awful recording today, actually. I've had stormy weather here, and it's been affecting my internet, so it's cut out about 3 or 4 times during this recording. So I guess we can start to round things off for this one, Aaron. Interesting film, not the best film ever, and it's arguable as to whether it's any better than the first one. I found it watchable because of, you know, all the things we've been talking about here, about these ideas of secret societies, about initiation, revelation, the sort of deeper messages that are being put across in relation to, you know, what secret societies are supposed to be and how they operate. So that being said, it was a difficult discussion to have because, despite being fairly simple in terms of the what happens in the plot in terms of, you know, characters going through a process, then having a moment of revelation, then going through another process. It's not all that complex, but it comes across as being very complex because there are so many characters, there are so many levels of deception. You know, each character thinks they've got figured out only to reveal, to find out that they haven't. And so I think it can be quite confusing to try and sort of revisit the plot and try and put it all together along with all of the kind of the esoteric and exoteric messages that are being put across. But I think, you know, if we look at this film as a whole, you know, there's a lot going on, but I think the basic message being put across there relates to, yeah, the role of secret societies, you know, the public perception of secret societies. So the characters in the film are initiated through a process of understanding. The audience is initiated into a process of understanding. Neither the characters in the film or the audience are initiated all the way, though, so there's still a lot being deliberately veiled, and I think that's probably the strongest thread that runs throughout the film is that, along with the idea that that a secret society is something that would stand in opposition to corruption and in opposition to things like the elimination of privacy and things like surveillance, and that they would be the forces in the world acting to counterbalance that. So, you know, it reminds me of films like National Treasure, you know, the Disney film with Nicolas Cage in it, where it presents the Illuminati or the Freemasons or whoever is being this, this benevolent force of good in the world, and, you know, all about virtue and philanthropy. Of course, we also see that despite this kind of this outer shell of philanthropy and virtue and morality, etc., it really is just a veil for power and ego, because this is how these characters operate throughout this film. You know, it's all about the ego. It's all about, as I said, getting one up on the other, getting revenge, fooling the public, being in the spotlight. And so I think that is, again, a fairly accurate representation of you know, how secret society culture operates on the inside in a lot of ways. So, yeah, we've been given, I guess what I'm trying to say here is, like a lot of these films that deal with secret societies, we are initiated into some kind of an understanding about how things work, but we're only shown as much as they're willing to show us. And, you know, the bigger secrets, the bigger kind of architecture of how all this works in the background is kept hidden. So, I mean, I guess a few more notes I just wanted to touch on before we finish up here would be that, as we referenced in the first film, the two of the people involved with this film were somebody called Boaz Yakin and a guy called Ed Solomon. Now, these apparently are real names. I've not been able to find information indicating that these are fake names. And obviously this is very interesting because these are Freemasonic references, you know. Yeah. You've got Boaz and Yakin,
yeah.
And
the
pillars of at the gates of Solomon's Temple. Of course, Ed Solomon being Solomon's Temple. So this is the Holy Grail of Freemasonry.
Yeah, you got the pillars in the temple itself.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So that's pretty obvious that the people who are involved in this film are secret society members. That is made obvious, not just through the film itself, but through...
Oh, my God, that is...
Yeah, these people, Boaz Yakin, come on. I mean, that obviously is a fake name, but there is no information as to, you know, what his real name is. So he goes by that, whoever he is. And you've also got the character of Thaddeus Bradley, which is interesting because... I was wondering whether this might have been a reference to Thaddeus Stevens, who was a, I think he was, it was a politician in the early 1800s, House of Representatives, and he was crusading against Masonry in U.S. politics. So he was he started the anti-Masonic party.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
I also remember It also made me think about the film The Brotherhood of the Bell. There's a character called Thaddeus Burns, and he is the FBI agent who the character goes and sees to try and expose the Brotherhood. So I don't know. I'm not sure if that means anything, but it's kind of an odd name, Thaddeus, and I've just seen it pop up a few times in relation to
Secret Societies.
I don't
know what the meaning of the name is, but these characters all seem to be like gatekeepers.
Gatekeepers, so, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, they're coming out in the public. That could be it.
That could be it, yeah. Mm-hmm. But
makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, yeah. I just I couldn't help but notice that, and so it's... yeah, it's interesting.
It's important just to note how many of these sorts of films there are, just explicitly talking about secret societies, the whole time mystifying the audience as to what they actually are, going back and forth a lot, causing a lot of confusion, and leaving the bulk of the audience just still with more questions. Like, well, okay, I know it's about a secret society, but it's just, in the end, it's a silly movie, so I didn't really get anything out of that. It's another one of those dumb movies I watch, boy, I love them. So I mean, this, but again, if you're reading into what they're actually saying, there's so much going on. Yeah. So there's definitely real purpose in secret societies putting these movies out as for a multitude of reasons. Yeah. Anybody who wants to know what's going on in the world and what's going on with secret societies has got to think about this and try to wrap your head around, like, okay, exactly what is it they're doing with all these movies? Because it's important.
Yeah, it is
definitely important.
Well, I agree. I think it's about putting across a number of different sets of understandings about these issues. So we're enticing the initiates, people who would be interested in secret societies, into the fold in a way, putting out a good image of ourselves as something that they would want to join. We're also sending a message out to the public that, I would say for the majority of people, no matter which way you really interpret the film, I think you're probably going to come away with some kind of a general feeling that secret societies are essentially benevolent. You know, that they're mysterious. I think some of the actions that they're involved in are morally questionable. However, they seem to be working for the good of mankind. And so we don't really need to know much more than that. And I think that general idea that, you know, would probably rub off on most people in mainstream audiences is being put across pretty strongly there and pretty deliberately, I would say, as well.
Yeah, that's definitely important. Yeah, so you got to think for different viewers, it's doing different things, and try to understand the motivations in writing something like this. Like, you know, a guy, again, Boaz Yakin, sitting there at his typewriter as he does it. What's going through that guy's mind? You know? Yeah. For somebody really thinking about things, you can start getting in those kind of heads, and I think that's useful in doing.
Yeah. And it's also just interesting to note that when we talk about films like this, as we have done in the past, that involve secret societies and involve issues of initiation, of revelation, of role play, and all these types of things, that there is never one message. And whenever we reviewed these types of films, we always come away with a multitude of interpretations and meanings on different levels. So this is something that's very, very common with all these films. There is never one, you know, there's never one overt message given by any of these films at all. You know, we never even get close to one overt message. It's always a multitude of different, often apparently contradictory messages. You know, and I think the interest really lies in that too, and the fact that you are getting what would appear to be conflicting messages and within the same film, and that speaks volumes to me. I think
that's the language of the mysteries, is symbolism, and that's how it works. It works on a multi-tiered system, the multiple levels all at once.
Yeah.
And if you're just, you know, if you're just seeing things as, you know, this equals that, and this is this way, and this is that way, you're not getting anywhere. So. Yeah, so try to think at many levels, and you'll be doing well for yourself.
And think also about the multiple levels of ethics and morality that may be in something like this, because it's not simply a case of different interpretations about events, about black and white, you know, binary issues whereby did this happen or did it not happen or did both things happen?
Yeah, it's not just that. That's the objective world. Yeah,
but when we're talking about issues of right and wrong that you would see in a film like this, you know, that there can be both at the same time, or, you know, you can understand something as being morally wrong to start with, and then, you know, if you're given more information, you could see it as being morally right. Now, whether it is actually morally right or not is another question, but it could always that argument can be put across as to where, you know, you might assume something to be, you know, unethical, and then, you know, come to understand that given more information, it was actually quite ethical to do so. So, yeah, these ideas are, you know, there in the film as well. So that's something people can think about. But, I think that probably just about does it for today. It's been another messy podcast, unfortunately. Tons and tons of hassles and distractions. But
it wasn't as a big old plate of spaghetti and meatballs. Sauce over the place.
Yeah.
I brought it back.
Yeah, we had spaghetti on the ceiling once again. Yeah.
But that's go back and listen to our last show to have that make any sense if you haven't done so already. It's real important that you do that.
Yeah, very important and inside information about themes and memes there. But yes, our website is tmpodcast.com. You can get us on Twitter at themesmemes. And we also have a YouTube channel, which is slowly but surely being populated with more material. Just Themes and Memes Podcast. You can also subscribe to the RSS on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Google Play, and TuneIn. Is there anything else we want to mention, Aaron?
No, that'll do it for now. Thanks for listening. You can give us a rating on iTunes and write up a little review. If you do that, it actually helps out a lot. So big salute to anybody out there doing that for us.
Okay, Aaron. Great talking to you, man. I'll catch you next time.
All right. Take care.
This podcast was recorded on the 2nd of October, 2016.